So I will talk about Pangaea and the way that we've gone over the last 20 years. I realized beginning of this year that we are already in the business since 1992. So the technical development was very fast, as you can see here from the ENIAC computer or SUSE computers up to the mainframes that we have now running worldwide there. So even the picture here in the middle is already the past, not existing any longer. This magnetometer, by the way, was one of the ways to prove the theory of continental shift by Alfred Wegener, which he was not able to prove at his time because he didn't have the data behind. There was no evidence for that. So today, the scenery has changed a lot, and today we are speaking of data-driven science. Something missing. Is there something to move forward and back? Salvatore?
Yes.
Some stick or so? Yeah.
We used it to be here. Somebody's carrying with that.
Oh. Is it expensive?
I don't know. I think we can try just
like that. Okay, just like that. Yeah. Okay, I will do. This is a figure that I used to show in these kind of presentations just to make clear what we are looking for. So we have here visualized by the Global Earth Observing System of System concept a circle from Earth observation system over assimilation to Earth system models, that is doing analysis and prediction and coming to some sort of decision support. And then in turn, after policy decisions, also getting a feedback on the capacities or the type of capacities that we need on the Earth observation side. So this is a valid circle. The point is that we would like to come from information to knowledge to orientative knowledge. And the question is, how can we assimilate the data that is behind this? So it is not only a matter of producing data, but also being able to structure the data, to assimilate the data, to make quality assurance on the data, to compile up the data so they can be used in various contexts. And one of the ways to do this, one of the concept was data publication. So I will not go through this list here because we've seen some of those already with Jan. I just want to make a remark because Bernard Schatz, he made this comment here. So a prerequisite for the verification of scientific results, that's clear. That's something that we need also in the context of an article for the review. But there needs also to be a benefit for the data producers. So the data producers, and this is our experience, it is not always that the data is one-to-one related to a journal article. Instead, we have automated systems producing data. We have authors who are compiling up their own data inventories. We have communities who are keeping data within their community structures. So the articles are interpretation on top of existing data in general. So that's just to make clear about the relationships. And there are many people who are working only on data, who do not have high-level interpretations that can be published in Nature or elsewhere. My personal view is most of the publications that we see today, articles that we see today, is simple descriptive science, not interpretation on a high level. So you verify your results in contrast to, or you're putting that into relation of an existing model in your science field, and you're discussing your results, and you give some recommendation in the conclusion. And that was it. So for this purpose, you could also have data papers simply concentrating on methods being used, what has been done, and the data. So. And for that, we need a benefit to the data producers, which is not existing so far. So that is why we have concentrated on the data publication concept. So what are now the prerequisites for publishing data? So for sure, we need to have quality assurance, quality control. So that needs to find entrance also into review procedures. We need metadata, structured metadata and data standards. So data need to be machine readable, because it's not the purpose to get a single data publication somewhere. The data need to be structured in a way so that it can be integrated. Only then we have the possibility to do really complex multidisciplinary approaches in science, or large-scale approaches in science. So the way, for example, to run models with observational data as constraints, having a product here, designing a product to run a model is something that has to do with science. So you have to compile up the data from many, many existing data sets worldwide, maybe. In order to be able to do that, key word here is efficiency. So if you have to scan through thousands of Excel files and find out about the semantics about within these files, you're facing the same situation as a reviewer. We've heard that here from Efke, you know, that have simply said, no, we don't want to go through all this supplementary material anymore. So we need to have machine-readable data and metadata. Then the citability, sure, we need to have citation standards for that. Persistent identifiers, as outlined by Jan. Licenses. So licenses is also necessary. Pangeo uses the CC BY license mostly. And then this is also forgotten. We need to have business models for running those data centers which are able to cope with data publication in the future. We are following the open access model, but for sure we do not have the money. Again, referring back, you know, to the talk of Bernard Schutz yesterday, we get money in science projects, you know, for producing data, but we do not get the money to bring the data online to archive them properly. But still, though, you know, we all are supposed to follow the open access line here. So if we would not do that, there's no chance of getting money from any subscribers. So this is not a way to go. Then we need to have, and that is an important point, we need to have certified archives. That is, they have to be accredited by some authority. So they are fulfilling certain standards, which are exactly for the goals that we are heading for, capable of doing things in the right direction and not supplying dumps of supplementary material files, you know. Okay, what is Pangea? Now for the Pangea part. We are an information system for long-term archiving and publication of data in the earth and environmental science. That means also biology. We are not doing genome data. We are doing some simulation data, but in general, we are doing the whole spectrum of geosciences, including biology. So this is a wide spectrum. We can only do that because we have the semantic background by our institutes. So the Alfred Wegener Institute has some thousand scientists. In Bremen, we have some 300, covering all different types of geosciences. We are an accredited World Data Center by ICSU, by the International Council for Science, since 2001. And we are also accredited as a World Data Center by the World Meteorological Organization, as a World Radiation Monitoring Center, and also in the context of their new information system, the so-called Data Collection and Processing Center. And we have large collaborations, broad collaborations with science publishers since several years. So I will go more into that. Our activities are project data management, long-term data archive, we call that by now a data library, data publication and data infrastructures. So for the project management, and this refers back to the data model, the business model that we are using. So we are not getting money on a data submission base or something like that. We are getting money because we are going into science projects. We are part of science projects. We're getting a share in the funding. And by now we have done some 140 European to international projects. And so this is where we get the money from. We have some money for basic operations, but all the rest comes from these science projects. And that's also the way how we can buffer people coming from outside and say, okay, we would like to archive our data with Pangea, because we have the additional money, so we're using synergies here. But certainly this is not a proper model on the long run, because now we can already see with the collaboration with publishers extending, getting more and more, we are also getting more traffic. So I estimated in 10 years we will need some 10 more people only to archive data that is coming from the journals corner. Okay. And we are a long-term archive, as said. We have open access, non-restricted data. As Eefke already said, some data are always under a moratorium, in particular in science projects. People want to publish their results first because before making them openly available. We accept any data from individual scientists to institutes and science and industry projects. We have funding for basic operation. We're doing long-term preservation of data. I point out here that this is not only a technical thing. So not only saying, okay, we need secure hardware and we need to migrate the data from one medium to the other one. So we have to also ensure the usability of the data, that is the integrity and the semantics of the data. If we are archiving data, let's say, from geophysics or other communities, they're using, in general, proprietary formats. So when they want to use the data, they use their software. So you have to keep, as an archive, you have to keep track also on which software is used, which version, are my data that I have archived still usable. So that imposes really a huge task also on data centers. But that is what classical data centers are in general do. Okay, for the contents. So we can keep any type of content. As you can see here, also audio records. So we're not limited here to either the scope of the data or the type of the data. For the contents, we have so far some 450,000 data sets. So you can always ask, what is data set? Behind that is 6.5 billion data items. A data item can be a binary block, a picture, a film, or something like that, but only also something like a number. So that is quite a mass. The granularity we've chosen according to scientific criteria. That is, if someone has produced something under his name or a certain lab or so, we've said, okay, if we are comprising the data from another lab and this one, this is not scientifically, this is not correct, because there are differences between laboratories or principal investigators, as well as if methods have been changing and so on and so on. So the granularity is quite reasonable. We are building infrastructures conform to global standards, certainly portal builder. We are a portal builder, for example, for the World Data Center System. We are building the portal since several years, but also for this project here. This is a very long-standing international project, the International Ocean Drilling Project, which is in place there since 1960-something, was that project which was able to prove this theory of Alfred Wegener of continental shift. So, and then we also have a broker function. That means part of the data we are filtering out for other portals, like from the biodiversity communities, as GBIF and OBIS the communities. Then we are building sensor reps. And we have a data warehouse. I won't go into our architecture. This is a little bit to frighten you. So when you were talking about metadata and protocols, this is And actually, what we are doing, we have a proprietary schema, and from that, via XSLT and other techniques, we are building dynamically all these different standards that are used in the different communities. Only for this one here, you know, for the biodiversity part, DGIA, not even in one single community, they are able to agree on one single standard. So that is a fact that you have to cope with when dealing with metadata. Okay, but the result of that is that we are showing up really in various contexts and using various portals worldwide. So we are not only relying on what is accessible directly from Pangea. Now for the data publication part, we are following here the OECD principles and guidelines for access to research data. We have peer-reviewed citable data sets, the DRI registry, I talked about that, and we have these collaborations with publishers. So by now, Elsevier, Springer, HU, Wiley, I won't list them all here now. And with data journals, as the Earth System Science Data Journal of Copernicus. And we are cross-referencing supplementary data with traditional publications. So this is the traditional model of how to publish data and articles. So as you can see, this is asynchronous. Data are published separately to the articles. And this is where we want to go for. That is, for the publishers, we want to get closer collaborations with journals and to do a common editorial together with journal editors and the reviewers to get a combined publication of data and article. So we have a data submission system here. Actually, a ticket system is standing behind that, so we are prepared also for these editorial. And for the cross-referencing, this is the data set in Pangea with meta information and map and all this. And this is how it shows up on Science Direct, on Skyverse, or on Scopus, so with a map here on the side. So this is the kind of stuff that we can do for all publishers so far. And this was a result that was given me by John Sears from the AGU. He has done some bibliometrics on data that is in the Web of Knowledge, and where also the metadata from Pangea is harvested in. So this refers to, it's not so easy to understand, this refers to a long-standing cooperation between Pangea and certain journals, and all the metadata information that is in the Web of Knowledge. He was able to do some bibliometrics and found out that those articles having data behind have 35% more citations than articles without data. So this is a very clear message where we should go. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And questions for Pangea and for publishing data? Please. Can you state your name and affiliation?
He misses the microphone.
Yeah,
it's arrived.
Yeah.
Aldo Rampioni from Springer. Very quick question about the sustainability on the long run of your work. I mean, because we have seen that the number of papers is growing exponentially. Behind each other paper, there are a bigger amount of data. So how much is sustainable on the long run? It's beautiful, and but how?
You mean the facility as such, Pangea, the sustainability of Pangea?
Yeah.
So we are now in place for 20 years. Yeah. What you need more?
Yeah. How if the existing technologies do allow to keep on registering big sets of data, and that become bigger and bigger and on more papers.
Well, you mean the scalability.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So we started small, as I think we would hear now the next talk by Todd Vision from Dryad. So they also started small. You have to find a sort of a business model in order to get going on the long run. So you cannot rely only on provisions of data from your funding agency or so, or from your hosting organizations. So that is exactly what we've done. We have this business model going into science projects, and there is good reason for us to believe now that the funding organizations, they will make a shift also in their funding policies. And that is important, and that refers again to the talk of Bernard. So when you have large investments in research facilities, as let's say ships and stuff like that, just as a comparison, Polarstern, yeah, as a research vessel, costs 100,000 euros a day, no matter whether it's in the harbor or on sea. So when you're funding these kind of facilities, then in future we will also have the data management included as a funding component. So that is the way that we would like to go now for, because this gives us a better basis. So whenever we have a research institution running some equipment, we have also priced in then the cost for the data management. So that is our future business model.
Other questions? I do have one question. Can I have the slides back, please?
Which one you want to see?
The workflow, the modified workflow for publishing.
Okay. Oh, they're gone now.
Can we get the slides on the screen?
Yeah, just a moment.
No, no, it's not you. It's somebody in the back has to tweak something.
That one you meant?
Yes. So we have been talking about bells and whistles, and we have been talking about modification of workflows, even modification of workflows when ORCID is concerned. So the author had to do more things. Now, since this is a publisher conference, can you discuss a moment which is your vision on how publishers should modify the way they intake information from authors in order to accommodate this?
Well, this is already what we are experiencing. So we have some chief editors who are aware of that there is a possibility to archive data with Pangea, and then we are having a common review process. That means the data are reviewed also by the reviewers of the article. So they're going into the data. We are supplying them with a DOI of the article temporarily, and after the article is approved by the reviewers and the editor, we also are closing up our review and then publishing the data. So this is a synchronized procedure, and we are prepared also to automate this from the editorial systems of the publishers, connecting that to our editorial system. So, for example, we could pre-populate part of the meta information that we are gathering from the side of the publishers that shifts then onto what we are using. So that is a very simple, practical example. But the essential thing is to extend the review here and to make also the review on the data easier. That means the next thing that we are now doing is also bringing up some simple visualization tools for reviewers and so on and so on. So this is the way.
Thank you once more. And with this, we can move to the next speaker. So we...
Oh, there.
Thank you.